So we've analysed the shear forces and the bending moments of the three-point and four-point bending. The three-point bending is much more susceptible to the sample properties, like if you're unlucky enough to have a defect right underneath the point of loading, then you will get premature failure. So this is more representative of the average property of the sample, and this would be much more sensitive to kind of localised properties of the sample. What we're trying to do, of course, is we're trying to get useful numbers that designers can use when they build structures. So we have to have tests that are representative of the sorts of things that will happen in reality. And from that point of view, the four-point bending test is more useful. We don't have these shear forces operating between the two points of loading, whereas here, of course, we've got a maximum shear force operating at the point of loading. So we're taking the shear force out of... It's not such an important consideration in this type of test compared with that sort of test. So they will give you different bits of information, basically. And we have a constant bending moment between the two points of loading, whereas here we've got a change in that bending moment up to a maximum at the point of loading. So there are differences between the two tests, and they will give you different information. So this is more sensitive to sample preparation, sample conditions, and the rate of loading, of course, is something we have to bear in mind. The sorts of graphs that we're going to get out of this are going to be stress strain curves, and we're going to get failure points, very much like we did with tensile tests. But of course, now we're measuring partially compressive and partially shear and partially tensile load. So these are much more representative of the sort of thing you'd get in a structure. With small scale testing, you'll be working with clears, but for representative testing of timber that's used in structural applications, you will work with realistic size samples. You have to, because you need to know real numbers for real calculations. So then we're going to get added complications that we're going to get, although we try and get the grain as straight as possible, it's going to be impossible in a very large sample. We're going to have knots in that sample. It's important that we condition the sample, but conditioning very large pieces of wood can take a very long time. So you have to plan these tests well in advance. You can't just take samples from the forest and test them and expect them to be representative of dry wood, for example. You have to dry the wood and then you have to condition it so you can compare tests in one place to tests in another place. So you have to have these pre-conditioning regimes. When we're testing laminate samples, like laminated veneer lumber or paralam or glulam type structures, then they're more, they're designed to take a lot of the variability that timber has out. So particularly if you have the occurrence of knots, you can either, with some species, remove the knots altogether where the knots occur in whorls around the trunk, so you just chop those sections out. Or you just even it out, you just have knots more evenly distributed throughout the structure of the wood. Or if you know that you've got a tensile face in a sample that's going to take a high tensile load, the bottom face of a sample, then you can ensure that that is the best quality timber, it's not free. There's ways around it. And of course you can use structural elements that are part composite, part solid wood, so the sorts of things that you might use for those sorts of applications would be I-beams, where you might have a web that's made of some composite, like laminated veneer lumber, and then you have top and bottom sections, which perhaps are made of solid timber. So they would behave very differently from solid wood. So there's definitely a move towards composite timber products for structural applications. Of course, you can make them as long as you want. That's another big advantage. You're quite limited when you make timber from trees, or make structural elements from timber from trees, because there's a limit to how long the timber comes. So with structural elements that are composite in nature, you can make much longer elements.